so excited to have you back on the Fitlandia podcast. And I'm even more excited about today's topic because I know the idea of exploring moderation with alcohol is something you and I are like really interested in and passionate about. But I recall from your Instagram post that you are actually doing some really cool research on it. So I just want to say, again, welcome back. It's great to have you.
Oh, thank you. I am so excited to talk about this topic. I don't know where I've blogged about it and stuff and posted about it. I don't know where it's going to go, but I think it's such an important topic, especially for like the middle-aged woman who loves wine or cocktails, whatever.
Right, exactly.
I mean, I went through a martini phase, you know, myself too, but like wine is something that has been a part of my life for a long time. And I played around with abstinence and moderation and this and that. And I'm just like, where do I want to land? Okay, I'm 50 years old.
Yeah.
What do I want? How do I want to live my life? And I'll tell you, I don't want to be hungover. I don't want to feel puffy and foggy and unproductive. So I know that, but does that mean that I have to give it up entirely? Can I find that balance, that moderation without going extreme restriction, which is so my personality?
Yeah.
Like, oh. It's all or nothing.
I you love know? That you say that because so you and I are in the same boat. First of all, my love is with wine too. And just to catch everyone up to speed, Evelyn and I connected after I was on Leanne Vogel's podcast, and I started talking about my love of wine and how in 2015 I did a full year sober. And that episode caught the attention of a lot of people, which I'm excited that we're talking about it. We're ending the stigma. We're not labeling ourselves or others alcoholics, although I do want to throw out a little caveat with this episode that if you are struggling with a substance addiction, whether it's alcohol or drugs or any other kind of addiction, because we're going to be touching on that, please seek professional help. We are here talking about exploring this idea of moderation. And I am a huge fan of therapy, so I just wanted to get that out in the beginning. But I too am like you. I often say to people, I'm like a light switch. I'm either on or off. And so This idea of exploring moderation is really curious. And my husband and I talk about it all the time because his thing is sugar. And we're wondering, can we moderate or is it on or off? So talk a little bit about some of the research that you've been doing, some of the books that you've been reading, and how you're exploring this personally.
Yeah, well, one of the best books that I've gotten, I highly recommend it, is called This Naked Mind by Annie Grace. And she has a podcast, and she's got exciting things coming because she has, I mean, I know that there's other authors, I just didn't find them until I found her first. But she has been in her writing really in such a profound way, gotten away from the whole, you're either an alcoholic or you don't have a problem with alcohol. So you're either one or the other. And her approach isn't necessarily about abstinence, although that's where she lands herself personally, because, and we'll get into this, like it's easier to abstain, believe it or not. I mean, you might have experienced this yourself. I know I have. I mean, it's not as fun sometimes to abstain, unless your mindset's right. But when it takes a lot of energy to moderate and to be mindful when you're in that moderation zone, because it's very easy with the nature of alcohol, it's a toxin, to just slip into, let me have another one and let's have more. Oh, might as well finish the bottle and that whole thing. So This Naked Mind is an amazing resource for somebody who wants to explore the middle ground that is between you're a full-blown alcoholic versus you want to have a different relationship with alcohol. So that's one of my biggest recommendations. Another podcast, though, that I like is, and she has a book called Why Can't I Drink Like Everybody Else, which is like such a great title.
That's such a great title.
Yeah, isn't it? Her name is Rachel Hart. She has a fabulous podcast that really explores. So Annie Grace goes into more of like alcohol's you know, it's a toxin, it's bad. And so you kind of like, you're turned off by it. That's kind of where I felt as I was reading it and when following her work, like, yeah, she really is not on board with alcohol at all. And like, and that's great. And it's like worked for her, and it's probably helping so many people. And I can see it is on social media. Rachel Hart is more of losing, and Annie Grace is this too, but losing your desire for alcohol and having awareness of like the urges and the patterns that we have, and like starting to kind of shine the light on those so that the use of this substance, whether it be sugar or alcohol or shopping or gambling or whatever,
Yes.
is something that's then in the background as, okay, that was an old pattern. Now, how do I move forward with this new pattern that's more aligned with who I am now as a human being? So, Rachel Hart is, and Annie Grace are two of the like power women in this field that I've seen. I'm sure there's so many more that I just haven't come across yet, but now that like the floodgates are open, I just find more and more. And then Dr. I think it's Adi Jaffe wrote a book called The Abstinence Myth. Again, going into more of the statistics around alcoholism and the traditional model of, you know, abstinence and 12-step programs. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but that because that model is so all or nothing, it prevents a lot of people from seeking help if they
Yes.
want to either control their alcohol or have a different relationship with alcohol. So those are three things that come to mind that are that were just they're just really in this whole realm of like, how can we find our way, our own unique way, just like we do with food, that gives us a balance that we are have a you know, our eyes are wide open, we're very aware in the process, and we're letting go of the patterns of like using alcohol as like to not feel our feelings, or if we are using it to relax, to just be very mindful of its effects. Is it really making you relax, or is it actually heightening your nervous system, which it does because it's a toxin? So that's what I've been playing with lately, and I love it because it's like, oh good, I'm gonna get rid of that all or nothing. I mean, I
Oh
come from a whole orthorexic Whole30, and not to bash the Whole30, but like, is it paleo? If it's not Whole30 or paleo, like it's bad. You know, that labeling of
Yes.
this is bad, this is good. So I come from that kind of personality. So it's kind of nice to be able to experiment and play around with the moderation, not only with food, but as also with alcohol. So.
Oh my gosh, you bring up so many things I want to talk about. So my 30 Days to Thriving protocol is very similar to Whole30, but we also remove fruit. And so people go into it with this all or nothing, I have to be perfect, when really the intention is to help figure out what foods work best for your body. And doing a
Right.
clean elimination and then at the end adding foods back in one at a time. And it's the same whether it's any kind of reliance, and I always talk about sugar, refined carbs, and alcohol, but it's those things that stimulate the brain, right? That fire up the reward center. And what is going on in our lives to make us either want to do that, right? It could just be, hey, I want to celebrate with my friends, it's New Year's Eve, and I want to enjoy it. Or, like you said, I had a crap ass day. And I just want to unwind. But like you said, is it really helping you unwind? And the point is, we get to become mindful. And what I like, you also talked about, this idea of overuse every day. I mean, that was me. I was a bottle to a bottle and a half, and on a really bad day, 2 bottles of wine every single day. 192 pounds overweight. Crazy insomnia, dragging myself out of bed to my 70-hour work week, traveling 3 to 4 weeks out of the month, completely out of control. To now, like, yeah, what is it like? And I'm in this, so I want to hear where you're at in the process. So where I'm at in the process, like I said, 2015, we're here wrapping up 2018. This is 3 years later. And I'm still figuring out my relationship with alcohol. And I don't say that to put like the oh crap mindset in anyone about, but it's a journey, right? And you have to like settle into this notion that you're going to be figuring it out. And as your hormones change in our 40s and
Yes.
50s, we have to refigure it out. And I think that's where I'm at right now. But I'm in this right now where I'm at today in this moment. And I would love to do a follow-up show with you in like 2 months is to say, all right, 2 times a month, I'm going to pick. And I'm going to plan when I drink. I notice when I plan to do it, I'm much more in control. So I'm like, I've got 2 times a month. I'm going to mindfully and intentionally imbibe. And so I'm trying that out. So I would love to know where you're at, what you're doing.
Well, so where I'm at is less of a structure and more of a flow. But I've been there with the whole, okay, I'm only going to drink in this situation. Like, we camp. So, or I'm going to practice not drinking while camping. And I did that this summer, which was huge. And I had a great time. So a lot of it is the proving to yourself that you can have a good time, and you abstaining for a year. I mean, I've done mo a month, and obviously it's through pregnancies. I've not drunk any wine, but so you have a much more experience with abstaining than I do. So without having like a medical reason like pregnancy to like prevent
Right.
that. But so I've done months. And so what I found with my pattern was like, okay, I'm abstaining. Let me not make any social plans because that's going to just suck. Because, like, if I can't have wine with my BFF or even my family, like, that's just going to be terrible. To, faking it, like, okay, I'm going to have this kombucha and, instead in a wine glass. And, so
Yes.
trying to like put lipstick on a pig, like it still sucks. I can't have any wine. But so that was my mentality before. Now it's like, it's intentional. Like, I want to be the person. So my intention, my mind zoning mantra would be, and this, I've blog about it and I say it all the time actually to enforce it, is I'm the person that can take it or leave it.
Oh,
So
I love
I
it.
intentionally practice like leaving half a glass of wine on the table and walking away out of the restaurant, which would be absurd before. Like it's like, oh, let me get every little fat last drop, right? I practice just having one glass while the others around me socializing are having more. So
Yes.
I practice that now, and it doesn't mean like, oh, I'm only having one. If I want to have two, I'll have two. I usually don't want to have more than two, and but if I do, then I have this awareness of like, okay, how did I sleep? How do I feel the next day? And I really kind of, have this come to Jesus moment of like, that is just not, that's too much, because
Right.
especially if I don't feel good the next day. Sometimes I surprise myself and I feel fine, I sleep fine, I wake up fine if I have more than two. But usually not, because my system just doesn't, it can't tolerate as much as it used to be able to tolerate.
Yeah.
So, and I have the same pattern as you with my corporate job. I know we have similar backgrounds in terms of a very demanding corporate job, and wine was just the way to kind of get through that phase of life. And
Yes.
now we're in a phase of life where it's like we're creators and we're like content creators, and we want to serve people. And alcohol, even though there's some residual patterns from that, using alcohol since I was in college,
Sure.
basically to have fun. Where I'm at now in midlife is like, I just don't want alcohol to be a thing. Like I said, I want it to be, it is something I can take or leave. It's not a big deal.
I love that. I'm going to make sure that that's in the show notes. I'm the type of person that can take it or leave it. Because we do label ourselves, whether anyone else labels us or not. So I like the idea of including in that little mind zoning mantra, I am the type of person. Right? I started off saying, I'm like that I'm the type of person that's on or off, right? I'm like a light switch. And so if I start to say to myself, I'm the type of person that can take it or leave it. And that's an empowering statement, right? That's not like, oh no, if I have it, I'm having it. Or if I'm not having it, great, I won't. But no, I'm the type of person. And I say this all the time, but even the teacher needs to be the student at times. that there's statements that I can take into. So I'm gonna blow that one up and give you all the credit and share that with everyone. There's something else I was thinking about too. You and I, self-soothing with alcohol and our crazy corporate careers, when that was actually the worst thing we could have been doing for ourselves. And I wanna make that very clear so that everyone listening that might not be aware of how toxic alcohol is for the mind and the body, how disruptive it is, for hormones, for everything, right? Our brain function, our gut health. Like, I just wanna make sure everyone knows it really is a toxin. And so what we were doing to self-soothe was actually the polar opposite of what we should have been doing, which is putting sleep as a priority, which means no alcohol, putting good nutrition as the priority, making sure that we move every day to bring, the oxygen to our brain and support keeping cortisol levels low and managing stress and keeping that primal brain at bay. So I just want to make sure everyone like knows, like if you are in the craziest of crazy situations, I want to get you out of it and actually do the opposite of soothing with alcohol and get you to manage it better, right? We would have managed that stress so much differently.
And Annie Grace and This Naked Mind does such a good job of bringing the evidence, the science, the physiology of why we might have started, say, in our 30s or 20, late 20s, whatever, having maybe a couple drinks, especially in the corporate world, like one or two might be fine, to it working its way up to a bottle or a bottle and a half or even two on any given night, depending on the stress level. And there's a hormone called, we've heard of endorphins, right? Those are feel good, exercise induces endorphins. But with alcohol, it produces a hormone called dynorphin. I think I have that right. It's spelled out in her book wonderfully. But basically, the physiology, the brain activity is, that whole dopamine need for our reward centers calls for the alcohol. It doesn't necessarily give us pleasure. And over time, we don't gain the pleasure of alcohol. We become, it's almost like you might have experienced this with coffee. Like when you first started having coffee way back when, for me, it was like, oh my gosh, I can feel it. And then now, like, I can eat, drink a whole pot and I'm like, I'm barely feeling anything. So we become less sensitized to it. And the same thing happens with alcohol. But we also, with this, dynorphin, we don't feel the pleasure that we felt in the beginning with alcohol. But
So
the
we're chasing
association
that.
is we're chasing that buzz, but we're not getting it. So we need more and more and more and more. So it is a slippery slope in terms of like the activity of alcohol and our physiology not really meshing, which just brings more need to either choose to abstain, and that is a great decision, or choose to moderate and be very mindful of the potential of wanting more. And that physical addiction is a real thing, physical and emotional addiction. But even if it's like, if you don't consider yourself like addicted, like in the alcoholic sense, there is still activity that is addictive alike that is occurring in the brain and through our nervous system that drives us to want more and more and more. So that's important to know. That's the kind of the unique thing with alcohol versus, say, food. I guess sugar probably has the same kind of triggering behavior, but the alcohol has this unique kind of effect on the brain, and other like addictive drugs do as well. Yeah.
Oh my
And it is a
gosh.
toxin. Yeah. Yeah. She explains it much better, and I hope I'm not butchering some of the science, but that really hit me because it was like, yeah. And I have got a few clients that are like, I can't even, I can't just have one glass of wine. Like, that does nothing for me. And when you abstain, and you probably found this yourself, especially going like a year, and you have your first glass after you've
So
reintroduced, it's
good.
like, holy moly, like, yeah, so you reset a little bit, right? And but then you can probably quickly be like, oh, wow, it's easy to have three now, like after a few weeks or whatever.
Totally. Some of the things that I learned and doing a full, so my reason for doing a full year sober is I really wanted to 180 my relationship. I hadn't even done this awesome research that you had done about what's happening in the brain. I just, my gut instinct was that I could change my relationship, and that's really what needed to happen. And by the way, I will make sure there are links to all these amazing resources you're giving us in the show notes. But I wanted to go through every birthday, every holiday, every wedding. I mean, we went through weddings. So the one thing I want to share the story. So about 6-7 months into my sober year, there was a wedding, East Coast, Cape Cod, with all of my like classically heavy drinking buds. Like, this was it. This was the mother of all tests.
Tests, yeah.
And they knew it too, because they had only known me as a heavy drinker. So for me to, by that point, I was probably 40 pounds lighter, which was another really big motivator for me, because I was 192 pounds at my heaviest. So I was 40 pounds lighter, feeling great. And I had to go into this scenario knowing, right, that dreaded, oh my God, everyone around me is going to be hammered and I'm the only sober one. Fortunately, my husband who was with me was sober too. But I totally, like, in that moment was able to reframe my experience. And first of all, it was easy because I just like cut up the dance floor and just laughed and just gave my brain other way, not even like intentionally or knowingly, like, oh, I need to do this. But my brain was totally taken care of because I was dancing and laughing and storytelling and connecting, which our brain loves, all that stuff. So I didn't even miss that. And then just being able to observe everyone around me, it actually, instead of it being annoying, it was actually quite, I could find the comedy in it, if you will. And so so getting through the whole year, what was really interesting when we did start drinking again, I was fine for a good 6 to 8 months. But then I released my books in, when was that? September of 2017 or October of 2017. So just about a year ago. And I didn't realize what a trigger celebration was for me, because I had only associated my alcohol use with managing my stress. So here I was like celebrating and I'm like, yay, it's exciting. And that rolled right into the holidays. And I just said, okay, I surrendered to it and I allowed myself to do whatever was going to happen. And I gained another, I think, 15 or 20 pounds. And I didn't shame myself. I just became very mindful. And then it was like, okay, we're doing another 6 months sober. So I needed these like long stints. And that's kind of where I'm at now, right? Is this, this exploration of what does it look like for me? And I hope this episode starts peeling the onion for people to get educated, because you know me, I'm all about the education piece and then rewiring the brain. The education piece becomes the motivator for this idea that I can, right? If I know it, now I can't unknow it, and that's going to fuel me forward. So what have you learned in the books about like tips and tricks to moderate?
Well, so Naked Mind doesn't really get into the tips and tricks to moderate. Her thing, and she does have a podcast on this, and the podcast is called This Naked Mind. She kind of talks about how it takes a lot of energy to moderate, and it's easier just to abstain, and especially when you have a good time. And I've proved that to myself. And honestly, I had a thought of like, oh, am I going to experience, it's called spontaneous sobriety, where you just walk away from it. And I was like, I was very open to that. Like, oh, I'm good. And then I was kind of like, that's kind of where, can you hear me?
We lost your connection there. So, So we'll just leave a little bit of a blank pause here and just double check to make sure your apps are closed out. And then I'm just noting the time so my hubby can cut this out, and we'll leave a pause, and then I'll ask you again.
Okay. Let me make sure that's closed. Boom. All right. Okay. Does say poor network connection.
It does.
I don't know if that's on my
Is
end,
someone else
probably.
using your internet right now?
No, nobody's home.
Okay. Well, we'll just go with it. So I'm just going to leave a
Okay.
blank and then we'll pick it back up.
Okay.
So, in all of your research, what tips and tricks did you learn for moderation?
Yeah, so with Annie Grace's book, This Naked Mind, her thing is moderation takes so much energy. It's possible, but it does require that constant vigilance and mindfulness because what you don't want to happen is for you to be yo-yo. It's almost like yo-yo dieting, where you
Yes.
restrict, 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 and then you binge, and then you're always chasing that. You know, what's the right diet? It's almost like finding the right balance with alcohol. And for some people, that is none. I kind of equate it in some of my writings. I'll talk about, gluten. I can't eat gluten. I'm not celiac, but I've tested the waters enough through my Hashimoto's journey that, oh, you know what? Maybe I can do gluten because I didn't have like, when I'd have it, I'd be running to the bathroom. But I would always have struggles with losing weight, or I'd feel puffy, or I'd feel like in my joints and stuff like that. And so finally, I just came to the decision, like, I don't eat gluten. I abstain. I just don't eat gluten, and it's totally fine. I don't feel deprived. I don't like, oh, I wish I could have bread. Like, I don't even care. I just don't eat it. And so I kind of equate the decision to not have alcohol kind of the same way. Like, can I manage it, or is it just too much, or is it doing too much damage to my body where it's not even worth it, or where it becomes that slippery slope? So the tips that I feel in terms of moderation that I am drawn to myself are Rachel Hart's The Take a Break from Alcohol podcast and her book. And that is just having an awareness. She's got some worksheets and meditations and stuff like that that I like. And I've created a few of my own that help my readers so that, you kind of work through and determine, like, is this working for you or isn't? What are the underlying drivers for the behavior? What are you trying to avoid feeling? And that's the deeper area we need to go, like going back to our corporate jobs. Like, we needed to get out of those careers or change them in some way if it was possible, because they were just soul sucking, right? They just were, it was just, we're part of, I mean, I can only speak for myself, but I felt like I was part of a system that just had no soul, and it
Oh,
doesn't.
yeah.
Corporations don't have soul. And I was just trying to strive for more titles and more money and more responsibility for what? So I could drink more wine and feel crappy, that kind of thing. So anyways, and that's the deeper conversation that needs to happen. And it could be related to your relationships or, other things that are part of your life that aren't in alignment. That's the root cause. The alcohol is just a symptom. And the overuse of alcohol or food or shopping or whatever ever is, if it's out of control, it's probably because there's something else going on in your life that's out of alignment. So we want to point the finger at, like, oh, it's the alcohol, but it's not. That's just a substance that we're using or behavior that we're using that is compensating for a life that's not in alignment with who we are or what we need to be doing.
Oh my gosh,
So.
that is the wisdom bomb right there. Because I have noticed, I'm like, why am I drinking so much right now? This is unlike me. And I'm like, what I tell all my members, like, okay, let's look at what's going on in life. And I'm like, well, no wonder, you knucklehead. Like, I had every intention of taking 3 months off because I knew I was like working too much. I needed a break. And what happens? I actually load on three major projects this fall. And so not only did I not give myself this intended break that I meant to take, but I'm actually working more and with a crazier, tighter deadline, which is my pattern, right? And I think it's really important for people to get honest about their pattern. I love that you talk about your drinking, your food, your gambling, your sex, whatever is all related to an unbalance somewhere else in your life. So my overuse with alcohol is really my overstress in my work patterns. But I think the more interesting thing is, why am I falling back into that work pattern? Like, where
That's
is the
another layer.
yes. And it always comes back to fear, right? Because if I felt fearless and that I was abundant and taken care of, I'd be like, okay, let it unfold as it's meant to. What am I afraid of? Whether it's I'm not going to get my legacy out there, I'm not going to help enough people, I'm not going to get it all done, whatever it is.
Yes, the comparison trap. And now, as an entrepreneur in this kind of online space, that is a huge thing. I'm there too.
So
I think I
true.
do the opposite. I kind of check out, like, oh, I'm gonna give up. Like, underschedule myself. And I think I've had to do that out of self-preservation of my hormones. So it's kind of like I know too much. But we do
Yes.
use workaholic is
Yeah.
another bad label, but whatever. We do use our overwork, over exercise. It can be very healthy, positive, productive things, which our culture loves, as a way to not address more of that kind of like centered place that we need to be in. And so, yeah, so it's just those are just symptoms.
I love it. Well, I want to continue this conversation in future episodes. I really love that you and I are so open to talking about it. And I just want to bring more of our journey into the show. So with your permission, I'd like to just call this part one. And
Absolutely.
you and I just, every month or couple of months that we get back on, we say, all right, well, what are you working on? How's it going? Where we're at? And the other thing I want to encourage all the listeners to do is really two things. Especially from this last point that you made, Evelyn, is I want you all to dig deep. I want you all to really, with love and grace and acceptance, examine your life. Examine where things are out of control that's leading to these other areas where we might feel out of control, and we're trying to bring back more of that because it's that root cause stuff that we really have to work on. And I am a huge fan of therapy. I will try all the modalities. I've done several PTSD modalities. I do talk there. I do it all. So I'm a very, again, with that too, it's just like food or alcohol. You're figuring out what works for you and your life. But I just want to encourage everyone to do that. And then I also, one of my passions in having this dialogue with you, Evelyn, is to break the stigma about talking about this. And it really, I love that. I forget who it was that talks about this, that as soon as we put a label on it, people don't want to get help, right? And so, what I want to encourage everyone to do is to really dig deep into their vulnerability and head over to iTunes and leave a rating and review of this episode and tell us where you're at. Again, this is safe. It's safe to talk about this. It needs to be safe to talk about this. And let us know what you got out of today's episode, because I just want to build this tribe around, no, let's talk about it openly so that we start to learn more about our minds and our bodies, and we start to really live the lives that we know we're meant to live, feeling abundant in all areas, including our health.
Amen. Yes. I am so that I think this is the time. I don't know what is going on energetically, and I don't want to be woo-woo about it, but
Do
I feel
it.
like with these books, like it took the shame and the stigma, like you said, out of something that I felt like, gosh, why am I over drinking still? Why am I waking up not feeling great? Why did I do that? Like beating myself up. And then it just kind of like lifted that veil, and it's not an all or nothing thing. It's a very common thing. And I love that these resources are coming out and we're a part of that. You know, it's like, you know, if people don't find that book, maybe they will, and or maybe they'll stumble upon this podcast. And so I think it's just wonderful to just keep shining a light on something that's not that dark. It actually makes a lot of sense that we use wine or all these
Yes.
other behaviors in this day and age, because it's a lot. There's a lot going on, and we're trying to keep up with the Joneses and keep up with the person online who's doing amazing things. And it's like it's just hard. It's like we're just always chasing something. And so, you know, I so appreciate you reaching out. I knew when, like, I posted that, and I was like, oh yeah, let's talk
Oh,
about this,
yeah.
because we definitely clicked on this last time.
De
So.
we definitely did. And really, I want to wrap up with this. It is about ending the shame. It is about understanding that our brain is actually working perfectly to keep us in this state of safety and survival. Like, that's even the things that we think are negative, our brain is leading us to those because it wants to feel safe, like it's surviving. It just doesn't know the difference between, oh, okay, this might not be so good for me. It just wants to fire up that reward center to make us feel safe. It's the primal brain shutting down the prefrontal cortex. And so, knowing that, and then again, digging deeper and doing the work to heal some of these other areas is going to be really soothing to the brain. So then we can start to look at these other options. So,
Yep.
thank you again so much,
Thank
Evelyn, for being
you.
on the show. And I can't wait to schedule part two.
I know. Let's hope I'm not back up to whatever, three glasses of wine by then. But
If
yeah,
you are, we'll talk about it honestly, right?
we'll talk about it. I really can't see myself being going. It's all about how I feel the next day, and so I really, you know, I mean, knock on wood, I just feel like I'm in such a good place right now. So we'll see.
Well,
Part
you're
two,
an
we'll talk.
inspiration and you've brought these great resources. Again, I'll make sure I link to everything in the show notes. And before we wrap up, how can others get to know you even better?
Oh, EvelynD.com is my website. I'm Evelyn D Nutrition on Facebook, and Evelyn D Dominicus, just type in the first few letters, on Instagram. And feel free to reach out if you have any questions. And yeah, thank you, Krista. I'm so glad we
Oh,
connected.
yeah, me too. Thank you.
All right.